Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, good Sunday to you, and welcome to episode 26 of the Town Pod. I'm your host, Menos Kain, and these are my co-hosts, as always. From Mexico, we have Eagle Ceres.
Hola, everybody.
And from England, we have Lord Ra.
Hello, everybody.
So, how has your week been, guys? Anything crazy happened in your lives?
A few stresses, a few things at work, where suddenly, yes, this is why I'm doing this, because you asked me to do it, and then some people seem to forget that they asked me to do it. So they're like, well, why didn't you send me this thing? Because I did in March. But, you know.
Crazy people at work. I can sympathize. Started working again at the airport, and, I mean, it's been a couple of weeks. The very second day, we had a passenger coming into the office to literally pee on the ground. He literally walked in, started peeing on the ground, and when prompted, when someone asked, "What the hell are you doing?" his reply was, "I couldn't hold it in anymore." The sad part was that the bathroom was literally 5 meters away from the door to our office. Yeah.
I don't really want to know.
Okay, Eagle, how's your week been?
Actually pretty good. Just doing the overnight shift, as previously commented, and enjoyed a nice outing with the boys. We basically did a bachelor party without the bachelor.
You got that smashed, didn't you?
Getting there.
Yeah, we saw the picture, of the... Basically, in Mexico, you drink beer out of buckets or something like that.
In Tijuana. It's a weird custom we started doing in the, I want to say, 80s. Uh-huh. Where we get a nice little bucket, fill it up with a lot of ice, and just put beer on there to keep it nice and cold.
Oh, okay. And would you be okay with other parts of the world also doing something like this, or would that be cultural appropriation?
Hey, just give credit. Credit with credit.
Yeah, pretty much. Also, Russ suddenly dropped from the conversation for some reason. What the hell happened? Okay,
I blame his internet.
Yeah, damn the internet. Maybe. Either his internet or maybe his connection, we'll see. Or maybe Skype. What the hell are you doing, Skype? And anyway, so today we have a lot of subjects to talk about. We have, Excusez-moi. We have, at first, I want to touch on, I think this is the most recent thing that happened and people are all up in arms about, the thing with the gorilla in Cincinnati.
I can't really understand why some people are so in arms about it. I mean, yeah, it's a shame about the gorilla, about how they had to take care of the gorilla. Mm-hmm. But
you sound tired.
I tire of humanity sometimes.
So what exactly happened? I want to tell for people that weren't there.
So the Cliff's Notes is...
Yeah, pretty much.
A kid was taken to the zoo by his parents, and they were in the ape enclosure. The little kid basically... went past the railing and past the security gate and actually fell into the gorilla enclosure. Okay. Said famous gorilla saw the kid, pulled him away in a not quite gentle manner.
Yeah.
So after a bit of debate, the leadership of the zoo decided to put the gorilla down.
Yep.
As humanely as possible, but it's dead.
Is that the gorilla? Is that so? When you say basically, what exactly did the gorilla do?
It was dragging the kid away
through...
toward a quote unquote safe area.
Yeah.
The problem is, we don't know how gorillas truly think. They may be some of the closest animals closest to humans, but we still don't know how savage and wild they are. No, actually, we do know how savage and wild they are. But yeah, we don't know exactly how they think and what they're going to do. So there's a lot of people saying, no, it was being a hero.
Yeah. You don't know that.
I should not call them heroes. We don't know how humane they are.
Yeah, also, pardon moi for trusting the judgment of people who worked with these animals every day of their lives instead of random people on Twitter, because, you know, all of a sudden everyone has a degree in zoology all of a sudden. I don't have a degree in zoology, but what I do know is that gorillas can literally rip small trees out of the ground, roots included. Exactly. So imagine that kind of strength applied to a small kid. Like, the kid was, what, 10? 8? 9? I don't know. Yeah. It was a little dumbass. But imagine.
Yeah. So there's people on Facebook, actually, there's a group saying basically they want justice for the gorilla. I'm like,
what?
It's a gorilla.
It doesn't have civil rights.
I would actually want justice for the kid.
Yeah. So, I mean, you can't change his parents, but, you know, that poor guy,
you can strongly remind parents not to do what these parents did and not pay attention to your kid. You know what? I would be the kind of jerk parent that I would actually, if I'm taking my kid to a place that's not as secure as Fort Knox, I would always keep an eye on my kid.
Yeah. Also, it may also be that they were keeping an eye on him, but all of a sudden he got away. And then I had to ask, what the fuck kind of upbringing did you give your kid that he thinks is okay to just, you know, do stupid shit like get over the railing in a zoo for the fucking gorilla cage? I mean, what?
You know, it's a calamity of errors there. One, the kid got away. Two, he thought it was going to be safe just by peeking over the railing where he fell off. And then the gorilla, which is, as we've heard, is, while they are great animals, I can barely trust humans. I can
figure out the gorillas.
Yeah.
So
it's not the thing is, yeah, everybody's romanticized gorillas because of Gorillas in the Mist.
Yeah,
and everybody loves Winston from Overwatch.
Yeah, and then Phil Collins came along, and that the damn Tarzan movies. So
don't forget that gorilla from the Cadbury chocolate commercials.
Oh my God! Yeah. We actually saw that, like the original ones. Basically, did this. A little tidbit for the audience. We're called the Travelers because every year we try to travel together to a different country. The first time was in England, and we visited the Cadbury Chocolate Factory, and we saw the original animatronic gorilla from the ad. So that was an experience. I went and that's another Phil Collins song now that I think about it.
Now that we think about it, yeah.
What the hell is with Phil Collins and gorillas? Like,
I would not hazard to comment on that because I have no freaking clue.
Okay, so this took our turn. Let's not dwell on gorillas and Phil Collins anymore. And while we wait for Ra to get back on, I guess there is something really wrong with this connection all of a sudden. Let's see, we get to the first subject of the day, which is... I don't know if we... Can we call this, like, the Godwin Law? Like, I mean, there's not people, like, comparing stuff to Nazis, but there is actually, you know, they put Nazis where they should not be Nazis. We're talking about Marvel and the shit they did. I mean, okay, there is a new Captain America series. Is that right?
Captain America, Steve Rogers.
Yeah. Because they have to distinguish it with the other Captain America, which is fucking confusing, which is Sam Wilson, the Falcon. Because all of a sudden, we have... Will, welcome back.
Apologies for that. Technical problem. I had to reset the internet router.
No worries. Want to add anything about the gorilla?
Gorillas are endangered and they don't like being shot. They don't like being in zoos. Health and safety should have... risk assessment should have looked a lot harder at options, how children could get in and fall into the enclosure. So the health and safety equivalent, the health and safety people in the zoo and in the state where it happened need to investigate. You know, lessons have to be learned from these things. It's unfortunate, though, the health and safety culture that we have is if you don't assess the risks, you know, and think it's too risky, we won't let you do it. It's things like playing Conkers or or even a health and safety thing where you, in the porn industry, where they've got to wear goggles for bukkake videos. I mean, yes, I'm back. I'm lowering the tone. Sorry, ladies and gentlemen. The health and safety should have looked into some of these things on a more regular basis, and it's unfortunate that the child was... lucky the child wasn't seriously hurt, but it was quite traumatising to see the gorilla, like, shot. Even though he tranquilises it, they take a while. Even the finest anaesthetic that you can inject someone's just... doesn't work. It's not an off button.
There's also the fact that a dart the size needed to, you know, penetrate the skin of a gorilla would have fucking hurt, and there is no telling how the gorilla would have reacted.
The zoo get criticized regardless of what happens, whether they save the gorilla or they kill the gorilla. I sympathise, and I would require more information before I pass judgment. Fortunately, I don't have to, because that's not my job.
Well, I commented, you know what? The people at the zoo decided that a boy's life is more valuable, more important than a gorilla's life. Yeah, it's a shame for the loss of the animal, but you know what? The kid's going to be traumatised as it is.
Yeah, if they don't act and the child dies, oh, bloody hell. The shitstorm that brings upon the zoo and the zoo administrators and everyone involved. Oh, fuck no. Sorry, Mr. Gorilla. Like it or not, we humans value human life above all other life. That's why we eat animals.
Yeah, I guess every animal values the life of its similes more than other species. I think that's just a thing for life. Okay, so anyway, returning to what the fuck, Marvel? So let's just get straight to it. There is a new Captain America series, Captain America Steve Rogers, which is to distinguish from the other Captain America series and the other Captain America, because I think it happened around the time this new Beta World whatever thing happened. So the new Captain America is Sam Wilson, and Steve Rogers was an old man for a while, now he's young again, and now
Steve Rogers is Hydra.
Yeah.
Okay.
Steve Rogers is Hydra.
I could have bought Sam Wilson was Hydra, because, you know, the greatest respect to Falcon, he's a wonderful human being. He's not Steve Rogers, Captain America.
Yeah.
You know, Steve Rogers, who I believe could move Thor. That's, you don't get to move Thor if you're a sleeper agent for a Nazi. That's just not how it works.
Yeah, you could have, like, Captain America has done some pretty incredible shit, just from the strength of his conviction and the purity of his ideals, like lifting Mjolnir. He did that.
Oh, yeah.
He lifted Thor's fucking hammer. Mm. You don't do that if you're a white supremacist motherfucker. But no, all of a sudden, Captain is Hydra. Like, and that's not even the worst of it. It's not just the revelation that Captain America is suddenly was a Hydra sleeper agent all along. But first, there is the fact that they're trying to make the Red Skull kind of like Donald Trump, I think. I don't know.
The thing is, they're making Red Skull to be kind of like a Donald Trump analog. In which, well, he has good ideas, and he's out in public speaking stuff, and people are like, "Say, yeah, he's doing it right." He's saying it's like they're trying to shoehorn what's happening in society right now a little too hard, and they're doing it wrong.
Well, it's like, oh, he's a Donald Trump style character. Well, that's not going to date this comic at all, is it? I mean, whenever comics try to do real-world politics, in inverted commas, or vaguely real-world politics, it always comes across as being quite awful. Mainly because politics is incredibly nuanced and troublesome, and such. And comics, whilst they're, as a storytelling medium, has come on in leaps and bounds in the last 30 years. It's not that simple.
Yeah,
and it's
so they're trying to shorn Red Skull into real politics, but the thing is, as you said, especially with the kind of reaction this issue had, basically the thing is, I'm sure that eventually they're going to reveal, no, he was faking it, no, he was like a triple agent, shit like that. But I don't buy that because first, they say they've been planning this for a year or so, like there were hints in the other Captain America comic that this was going to happen. So they weren't planning this to be actually true, like actually a thing. Second, how the fuck are they going to explain away the fact that Steve Rogers threw Jack Flag, another superhero, and a guy that he actually personally trained, a guy who looks up to Captain America, he threw him off a fucking plane. The guy is dead.
I want to know is how the hell they're going to explain away the origin of Steve Rogers, where his parents are migrants. That he was the underdog. He was the little guy that got beaten up. And the fact that he was actually pure of heart was the reason why the super soldier serum worked perfectly on him.
Yeah, it's the reason why he didn't become the Red Skull.
Exactly.
Let's be honest. We are talking about a story medium, and nobody, with no few notable exceptions, Uncle Ben for one, nobody really dies. I mean, he really died. We'll bring him back.
That's kind of a fucking problem.
So, yeah. If you're not happy about something, then, I'll just wait for the next reboot. Or I'll stop reading this one and I'll read another imprint of it. So, I don't like this interpretation of Cyclops in Uncanny X-Men. I'll go read Ultimate X-Men instead. For example. I know, X-Men and not... Yeah, he's X-Men and not Captain America, but you know what I mean. Because I couldn't think of any of the other Captain America timelines.
These are symptoms of a very big problem. they just these characters have had their storylines rebooted I don't know how many times, and most of them I think in the last 20 years. Like Marvel and DC Comics have been rebooted collectively I think 6 times, 7 times, and
these in the last 30 years.
Since the 80s.
Yeah, okay, so yeah, there was a Crisis on Infinite Earth, but Marvel never went through something like that. DC did, and it was...
He's done it multiple times.
Marvel has only started doing it, I think, since the mid-2000s, something like that.
Marvel, what they've been doing more is creating other alternative Marvel universes, and then suddenly... Give more
attention to that Marvel verse, and then kind of bring it into the current one, or bring certain characters into the main 616 one.
Other universes, like now their latest event was basically fusing all the external universes into one. Just the 616 and the Ultimate Universe, which that line is officially dead, and it's. It's kind of a mess, really. It's kind of a mess.
Well, yeah. That's comics in general, I fear, yes.
Like, dudes, you need to make people die. It's that simple.
Well, status quo is king for many things. The thing is, if they kill off characters, they'll say, oh, I like that character, they get massive backlash.
Yeah, but the thing is, that's fucking lie. That's the problem.
I can understand what they... only occasionally pretend to kill off a character and then, you know, bring them back. Oh, Life Model Decoy or Doom Bot or whatever. Popular characters, Doctor Doom. I mean, he's a reasonably popular character, so...
There was a problem with the software. Go ahead.
This is a really popular character, that's true. Yeah, and if they kill him off, well, you know, who are the Fantastic Four going to fight? And, you know, heroes is only as good as his villains. Yeah,
make new characters, you know? There is a comic in Italy that's called... most people probably know it. It's Dylan Dog. They also made a terrible, terrible movie. I've been a fan of the character. You may not know this, but Italy has a very, big comic industry. Like, we have a lot of characters, old and new, some series end, and they don't get picked up again all of a sudden. Basically, every character is own universe. They don't exist. Basically, there is a character sci-fi, another that investigates paranormal activity, another it is mysteries, and everything like this. This Dylan Dog investigates monsters, horror, and stuff like that. So, the thing is, last year, they decided that, basically, you know, because time flies time passes in the comic as well. So, comes along, so this guy has been talking, like, there is a guy that is like a father figure for Dylan, is a police inspector, Bloke, basically it's a play on the English word, and what does he do? Mm-hmm. This guy has a running joke that he always talks, oh, they're gonna cut off my pension, they're gonna eat my pension, I'm never going to reach pension, and now he's actually retired. And they put someone else in his place.
Oh my god, they finally retired him!
Yeah, so, basically, there have been changes because people change. And you know what they did? They made another series. Like, there is the original series that continues with all the changes because, you know, time passes. And they made a second series, which instead is like a Simpson, the Simpson Factor. Like, there, it's always the same thing, nothing ever changes, and it's still, you know, the old version. And every month now, there is the new version that continues the story, and the old version for the nostalgic. That's a way of doing it.
It makes sense, and, you know, DC have also done... Well, I'd say something similar, but they've done something with the Elseworlds imprint, which makes sense because I want to look at an interesting take on a character, but they're not going to let me do this story on the main timeline because it's going to mess everything up. So, okay, you've written it, but it's going to put it in the Elseworlds. That's fine. Bloody hell. Captain America's Hydra. But saying that, it does explain why he changed size for Civil War 2. That's the only explanation for him being on the other side during Civil War 2. And you know, it's got to be some kind of Xanatos gambit. It's like, there we are. It's like the sort of thing Gendo Akari is looking at and go, tone it down, mate.
I got to get to some of that.
Oh, and why would you think Captain being Hydra is a good idea?
Yeah, for shock value. On top of that, not only Captain being Hydra being a good idea, but also doing that. Civil War is still in fucking theaters.
Yeah.
Yes, this is like the peak of Captain America's popularity. Captain America hasn't been so popular as a superhero since, I don't know. Because I wasn't a Captain America fan before the movies. Now I am. I mean, what the shit?
You know what? The thing is, Captain America had its fandom in the comics. And the comics used to be a lot more popular back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, when times were a lot more simple and we couldn't get stuff, and there was no internet.
to get
stuff off. When people actually had to pay for more stuff, and that's why they got so many sales. Nowadays, there's the internet, there's movies, comic book movies are popular, they're cool, they're well done. But I get what you're coming there on this, Manos. It's like, are you trying to ride this wave of uber popularity and crash it?
Yeah. Like, whoa.
Oh, speaking of double agents, maybe the person who arcaded Captain being Hydra is actually an agent for DC.
Yeah, but I don't know. I mean, I think that DC has had the general level of both universes is tending to, but. DC has had some individual better stories, I think, lately. So, I think I would just let them, do it. Just do whatever you want, because we already know that you're going to run yourself into the ground on your own, you know? Just sit on the riverside and wait for the corpse of my enemy to pass by. Stop Sun Tzu style. Oh, no, we'll say that. Like, I don't remember. Yo?
Sorry, didn't quite catch what it was.
Never mind then. Okay, let's talk on this subject.
Sun Tzu. Sun Tzu. Yes. And the Art of
War. If you wait by the river long enough, the bodies of your enemies will float by.
Okay, Sun Tzu then. Okay, last thoughts on this before we get into something a bit more serious, because this is actually something that happened in real life. Last thoughts on this?
It's a bad idea, but nothing ever stays the same in comic books. The only constants that you have is Uncle Ben is dead, Wolverine gets a bit surly sometimes. That's about your only constant. And Superman is bulletproof most of the time. Those are your comic book constants. Anything out? If you don't like it, just wait for the next reboot.
Yeah, pretty much.
Mm-hmm. If anything, I still think it's more of a mega cash in right now, taking advantage of Captain America's super popularity.
Cash in. The sales for this thing are going to tank.
It's the wrong kind of cash in, but they're still cashing in.
Yeah, but it's going to be like maybe the first number because people want to see how crazy these people are, but it's going to tank sooner than Hela, Queen of Hell, or Femtor,
poor Angela.
Angela, Queen of Hell, sorry. This doesn't make any sense from any standpoint whatsoever. Not marketing, not comic-wise, not even moral-wise, because I'm not, I think there are certain things they just don't do. Morally, and I know this is a comic book character, but this comic book was created as an answer to, what was going on in the world and in Europe. They want Captain America was like a symbol of of the American way, fighting against the evils of the world or whatever. But the point is, the two people who created Captain America were both Jewish.
It goes against the original intent and the spirit of the character. I know that they're trying to make it a change, try something different. Yeah. But why don't you try something different with a brand new character?
Yeah.
Why do you have to drag one character into the mud and then to later on say, well, it didn't work. Okay, back to normal.
Yeah,
besides which, it makes a lot more sense for it to be Black Widow, the sleeper Hydra agent.
Yeah?
Yeah, pretty much.
Because her loyalties were always under question. So her going, oh yeah, I'm on your side, suddenly hail Hydra. That makes more sense to me. So unless it turns out that this Captain America coming out as Hydra is actually Black Widow in drag... Which, that's a fine costume she's got.
That's then, my exoskeleton,
Then, if that's the case, then fair play. I would read the rest of that run to find out how they did that. But the shock twist that, he's Hydra, you want to find out no more, doesn't always work if you have a massive leap in logic.
Yeah, pretty much. I think what would have been more interesting? They introduce a new character. A character that's the opposite, the other side of the medal to Captain America. Like a guy who's... maybe a guy who's got a similar story, but instead of going the way Captain America did, he went for, it's like the anti-Captain America, because the Winter
isn't
Soldier...
Isn't that the Winter Soldier? Yeah, I was going to say, isn't that the Winter Soldier?
Yeah, it's not the Winter Soldier, because the Winter Soldier was, commies. That's after World War II. That's something that happened after Captain America went into the ice. So it's not exactly, direct opposition or contraposition... For the reasons Captain America was born to begin with, so someone that is ties in to what was going on in the 40s with all the totalitarianism and the white supremacy and everything else, that would have been a more interesting story, especially if it made some sense about some things.
But these people don't always. I did see something amusing though on this. Let's possibly wrap up with the final thoughts, because you may recall recently there was Give Captain America a Boyfriend, and then I saw somebody saying, actually, maybe it's best that they don't give him a boyfriend, you know, because he reflects badly on us, on his gaze, if he's a Nazi.
I saw different comments saying, well, they wanted to get him out of the closet. Wrong closet.
I like that.
Okay. Okay, next subject. Something more irritating, but I guess more flamboyant, because it involves... resident journalist and provocateur and all around the very... would it be right to call Nero, like Milo Yiannopoulos, insane? I don't think he's insane. He's more like... this guy...
He knows exactly what he's doing. It's calculated outrage. And
you got the math down right.
And to be honest, it's like... Anyway, it was amusing in small doses, but then he's like, as is often the case with media personas, it's like, oh, that's a bit too much, and I'm finding it quite tedious. And such, but yeah. And it's like, yeah, I can understand why you disagree with these things, but can you disagree with them in a better way, in a nicer way?
Yeah.
I mean, at least it shows that you're a better person than the people you're criticizing, which is the general rule, you know.
Yeah, okay. We're getting, I think, a bit ahead of ourselves right here. Okay, what we're talking about, what happened 5 days ago? What happened is that Nero was at a certain university that was called, I think, the Paul University. And he was, like, there for a debate, as always, that's what he does. And, okay, so basically, all of a sudden, Black Lives Matter activists stormed the stage, like, two of them. And one of them even threatened to physically assault Milo, like, he tried to punch him in the face before keeping, you know, disturbing the debate, you know. The guy had a whistle and kept, you know, whistling to not let anyone enter Milo talk. And the girl kept going, you know, being in his face and chanting Black Lives Matter, and stuff like that. And the craziest thing is that the event had a security detail, but they didn't intervene. Is that right? Right.
From what I gather,
pretty much. The thing is, a couple of activists got up on stage. They got right up on Milo's grill, and it looked like almost threatening physical violence. But Milo's like, yeah, do whatever you want. Go ahead, get it out of your system. Didn't even talk. Didn't rage. Didn't nothing. He just let them do whatever they want, because what they're doing is they're just proving that they're not really being proper activists. They're being bullies.
Yeah, well, so some put those people, started the conversation. Oh, yeah, and you've drawn attention, you've thrown something on the floor to get attention on it, and now you've got our attention and we want to help with the problem, but you better be walking away, not helping us clean up the mess, you know, resolve the issue. Or start the conversation. Well, what do you... What else are you going to do? You know, yeah. How does this conversation starting solve your problem? It doesn't.
Pretty much doesn't. No, and it's really crazy because the security was paid for, not by the universities, not the university, by the college, but by Milo and the organizer of the debate. They had to pay for these guys to be security, and they didn't do shit. Like, leave alone why. Leave alone what their motivation for standing around and doing fucking nothing. But you were paid to do a fucking job. I hope these guys get fired from whatever detail they are on. Because how the fuck does that reflect on you? You were paid to do a fucking job. And this ties in, I think... let's try and guess their motivations. Maybe they didn't want to, you know, because the guy, Milo is an asshole. Let's get it.
It's, oh yeah, he is.
It
oh, yeah.
makes sense on some things. On some other things, I strongly disagree with what he says. But he's an asshole that tells you know, it makes sense a lot of times. He's an asshole. But the thing is, you can't stop doing your work just because you don't like the person you're working with, the person that pays you. That's not how it fucking works.
You can stop going to work and not get paid for it.
Yeah. But you're in the middle of your job, you don't just up and quit and stay there and expect to get paid for staying there for doing nothing.
That's
not how work works.
Yeah. This ties in all the old, because it is not the first time that something like this is happening in America. Like, I think in the last year or so, there have been more and more cases on the news of people refusing service because the person in front of them, you know, was in disagreement because they didn't disagree with their lifestyle, with the life choices, with their religion, or whatever the fuck. And I can understand, okay, if you're a public servant, that shit is unacceptable. Because this is a public job. You are paid for taxes by public people. Everyone pays taxes. In America especially, where it's not like Italy, where you can just do whatever the fuck you want with your taxes and they never do anything to you. In America, if you try to, you know, cheat the fiscal system, you go to jail. It's a very serious crime. So everyone pays. I think basically, I don't know, Igor. Is there people who tried not to pay taxes in America? How does that go for them usually?
Oh, very not well. Very not well.
It depends on how much money they've got to hide, screw away offshore. as my dad is fond of quoting, the business of America is business, and you know, these people are. So the little people, the regular Joes, have to pay their taxes. Big corporations get away without paying their taxes. They avoid it.
More than avoid, they get huge breaks. I don't think it's like in Italy, because in Italy there are people like they get the huge breaks, but some even like make people make laws that avoid them to pay certain taxes is a clusterfuck. But it's more like in America, they get you know, a huge tax breaks. I think that's the reason.
Yeah, so, like, they're
single individuals don't have that luxury. No matter how rich they are. I mean, there have been a lot of, you know, influential people going to jail or paying stuff because of fraud, you know, fiscal fraud, right? In America?
Yeah. Or the really rich people that, for some reason, got found out on Panama Papers.
Well, yeah, we had a couple of famous celebrities who had screwed away money offshore in this country. It was Jimmy Carr was one of them. These tax efficient saving schemes and what have you. I earn £3 million a year. I don't want to have to pay half of that in tax. Thank you very much. Oh, if I do it this way. And if I'm technically working for myself as a limited liability company, I can reduce my tax burden by half.
Ouch. Yeah, shit like that. It's all the, you know, that it's kind of shady, kind of contorted, like twisted. I mean, I do that to do this to go there. It's shit. But the thing is, you don't. If you're a public servant, you're paid with tax money. And it's fucking inexcusable that you'd refuse service unless the person in front of you is physically assaulting you or being abusive towards you. You can refuse a service to people because they're conservatives and or gay or whatever, like that woman there. I don't even remember where she worked, but she refused service because the person was gay or something. Private businesses.
In that case, in that particular case, it was she was basically a person in government that refused to marry gay people after the law was passed in her state saying, yes, gays can get married here. And because she was like, nope, not in my state, guess who told her off? Barack Obama.
Yeah, because, there were people like saying, they wanted to supersede the fucking constitution. No. You can't supersede federal laws on certain matters. On that matter, you have to bend over. It doesn't work like that. So they didn't even know how the laws of their own countries work. And for private businesses instead, you can do whatever the fuck you want. But if you start refusing service arbitrarily, because... for not even a good, I'm refusing service because this person is a fucking warlord. That's kind of understandable, could be. I refuse service to this person because he's a murderer or whatever, stuff like that. But you refuse service to people because they're gay?
Whatever they do in the privacy of their own abode, and however freaky it is, has nothing to do with your ability or inability to do your damn job.
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much. And it reflects badly on you because, okay, no, I don't serve that one, but I serve that one, but not if he goes with that one. Like, okay, why the hell should I do business with you if you just up and decide to refuse service to me? Or like these motherfuckers did with Milo, they suddenly decided, already being paid, to just sit with their thumbs up their fucking asses. Is that the right plural? Asses?
That's pretty much what happened. They're like, either they were afraid of roughing up the poor, poor triggered students.
They
just decided to just stand there with their thumbs up their butts and saying, "Hey, we're just we're not seeing any violence happening here." Wink, wink, shub, shub.
Yeah. In the end, Milo he got up, took like all the the people in the audience, and they went with a small march up to the president's the school president door. Like, dude, what the fuck? That was kind of entertaining to see, like Milo leading this colorful wave of people, all marching right up to the president's office, demanding answers. Like that was
kind why is your security such shit?
Yeah.
Oh, it reminds me of
it. It was fun to watch.
I'm reminded of an article I once read on the Daily Mash, but I can't find it at the moment.
Yeah.
It was after we had it was in 2010 or 2011 when we just had our first coalition government for a long, long time. And it's like the government got in and they were having a lot of austerity and people were complaining. And it was like, well, you don't see the right-wing conservative people striking when the left-wing people get in. So why do the left-wing people strike when the right-wing get in? It's like, well, it's almost as if we just got on with our fucking jobs.
Mm-hmm. Now, funny thing is, a few days later, when he did his Dangerous Faggot Tour, that's what it's called,
yeah,
and went to the University of California, Santa Barbara, he got carried in like royalty, literally.
Oh yeah, he's on carried in on a chair. It's like, hey, it's like, oh, I get in.
Yeah,
like the queen he is.
Nero, you're an asshole, but you're an entertaining asshole. It's like a rapper, you know. He can't do and say shit that makes you angry, don't agree with. But that's the whole fucking point. If you get angry, that's exactly what he wants you to do. It's like Eminem in a sense. Eminem, that's his whole style. he sees and does some really... well, no, not does. Does, no. But in his songs, like, he does and says some really, really controversial shit. And he does it on purpose to get people riled up, to get people angry and talking about him. So, the same thing is...
starting a conversation.
He's starting a conversation, and he's doing it. He's doing it in a way that's very volatile to get people riled up, to not necessarily, well, probably purposefully, actually making some divisive lines, and then okay, everybody's divided. Perfect. Okay, let's start bridging the gap.
Yeah, and I want to. And these people, like these Black Lives Matter activists, particularly those pieces that were on that stage in this case, what divide are you trying to bridge here? Because seriously, basically say Black Lives Matter because, you know, because of course, because a human life is precious. But the thing is, everyone matters. That's true. Lives matter. You should treasure your life, no matter whose life. But you're making a very strong case for the contrary here. Because I'm not going to kill you. Like, I'm not going to say you deserve to die. But I'm... The more you act like an asshole, the less I'm inclined to care about your social and economical status. I'm going, like, full cynical here. If you be an asshole, and you act like asshole to people, and, you know, you find yourself socially isolated, and a pariah, or, you know, in a bad economic situation, I'm not going to say that you deserve it, but I'm not really going to care on extend a caring hand here.
Now, the thing is, the whole Black Lives Matter movement, if you notice, it's more located and pretty much centralized in the United States. Yes. Everywhere else in the world, you say Black Lives Matter, they're like, yes, and?
Yeah, it's like, well, of course they don't. What kind of monster thinks Black Lives don't matter? But yeah, well, it's doing a couple of points. One, they seem to pick and make bad choices for people to for causes to champion. It's like, yeah, he tried to get his police officer's gun. Now, I don't care what race you are, you try to take a police officer's gun, he's going to use it to shoot you, or his partner will, or her partner will. It's like, yeah, you try to take a police officer's gun, see how that ends for you. Spoiler, badly.
not really a spoiler.
Like, okay. Yeah. It's like, okay, and this person here, well, he was just committed armed robbery. And then you notice how some of the people, organizers in the organization, one of them was recently arrested for pimping a 17-year-old girl. It's like, yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's not going to win you any points whatsoever. And yeah, it's sorry. Like on top of the people that like lead this group, but there's also the fact of the you know, the people they chose to campaign for. Because I remember, I think it was last year, basically, at the same time what happened. There was this guy that was killed by a police officer. He was a hood rat, to use, you know, the slang term. He was, you know, a goon, how they call him. He was not a good person, he was shot. At the same time, a little girl, 9 years old, was shot because of a drive-by, because they told maybe someone else lived there. She was shot because of a drive-by while she was making her fucking homework in her own home, and she was killed. A little 9 years old girl. What do you think the Black Lives Matter made the most noise? No, they made any noise at all for, because the other person they chose not to campaign for was thoroughly ignored by these people. What do you think?
Well, she didn't fit the narrative. It's sort of, if they campaign against that, then they've got to look at themselves, and self-importance is better than self-awareness, because it's got more letters in it.
Yeah,
and that's how it works, right? Isn't it? It's like, oh, they treat us like thugs and gangsters. Well, whose popular culture glorifies violence and misogyny? You know, as if it's the thing to do. And you know, so yeah, so how do they work that one out? Because, you know, it was like, oh yeah, the, you know, what people sort of mentioned, when is the hip-hop community going to address its misogyny problem? And then you'll get shouted down as being a racist.
Yeah. It's not... Yeah, and that's the thing. Also, I think for the hip-hop community, because these, because I like rap. I like hip-hop. It's, you know, I'm a very lyrical kind of guy. And there is all these... also in the hip-hop community, there is like these lies of rappers and, you know, that are conscious and whatever. And now there is like a slice, including Macklemore, which is who is the most successful, like, after Eminem, I think he's the most successful white rapper ever, I think. Anyway, his second album sales are kind of tanking because of the content. Basically, he says, okay... One of his songs is called White Guilt 2. Like, yeah. I said everything. Basically, in his song, says, white people are, you know, are, you know, stealing the hip-hop music from black people, and they shouldn't do that because it's from black people, it's our cultural appropriation, and we're taking...
Hey, Macklemore! Macklemore, didn't you just shoot yourself in the foot?
Kinda, but the thing is, because he's, you know, whipping himself on the back, that's okay, because if he uses, you know, to atone and to say that he stole the Emmy from Kendrick Lamar, because, of course, the Emmys are fucking important, because, you know, it's not like every single... it's just a popularity and a trend contest. It's not about artistic integrity. And,
music awards haven't been... mainstream music awards are about popularity and what'll get them column inches and views and clicks.
Yeah,
it's nothing to do with musical quality, with the possible exception of the Mercury Music Prize and the Ivor Novello Songwriting Awards.
Yeah.
Aside from them.
yeah, but the thing that really gets me crazy is two things. First, that he says that because he was white, he had an advantage when deciding to become a rapper.
No.
Has he been living in the same world I live in? Because do you know the first white rapper who became mainstream? Do you remember Vanilla Ice? Because of that guy. Because
Vanilla Ice and Kid Rock.
He sucked. Yes. Because he sucked. He sucked. Why did I suck? The problem is people still laugh at the mere thought of a white rapper. So, but no, he had an advantage. He's independent. Like, he had to face the, you know, the big Sony, Universal. He had to face the system. He beat it, but no, he had an advantage. You know, he had a drinking problem, which he talks about, but no, he had an advantage. And the shit is that he calls himself a robber. Macklemore actually called himself a robber because he says that he's robbing the black sound of black people and he's robbed Kendrick Lamar of his Emmys. The thing is, he's always said that his success, his accomplishments are only because of the people around him, of the, you know, the fans, of his family, of his collaborators, of his friends, of his city. So going by that logic...
So by guilty by association, all of those people he's thanking, he's also calling robbers.
Yeah, accomplices to robbery. So not fucking, you know, it's not that hard to believe that his second album sales aren't that great. And second thing, because that was just the first thing, the second thing is that dudes... They say that, white people keep rap down, keep rap from evolving because they reap the benefits because there is comes a time that you can't... Kanye West. It's probably... Kanye West.
Now that's some cultural appropriation right there.
Kanye fucking West. This is the guy that uses popularity to sell people white t-shirts at 100 $5 and they go sold out of stark white t-shirts. It's not white people. It's everyone involved in the fucking hip-hop community, which is still mostly black. All the producers, all the rappers, most of them, 98% are fucking black. And they reap the benefits the most out of the black, out of the rap hip-hop community system. They get the cash money and they use their limited time in the mainstream, just to get as much money as possible before they become irrelevant. It's a system that they keep up because they like it that way, because it brings them money. Stop making this a race thing, because it's fucking not. Ugh.
Well said. Well said.
The whole thing there is, don't hate the player, hate the game. No, hate the game too.
Yeah, and
hate them both.
Yeah, it's a long-standing phrase and a hip hop meme, if you will, of don't hate the player, hate the game. And it's like, I'd rather not have to do this, but it's the only way I can get ahead. Oh, yeah. So that's why they say that. These people, the victim mentality. Because if I'm a victim and I succeed in case of in spite of everything. If I'm a victim and I fail because of everybody's all against me. And, it's only a fail if you don't learn from it. It's just like, it's only a mistake if you don't learn from it. It's only failure if you don't learn from the situation and get back up and try and do it again. I mean, sometimes you can't. Sometimes you miss your shot. It's like, yeah, well, that's that gone tits up now. I am buggered. So, yeah, I'm on my own now. But yeah, these people who insist that they're victims and oppressed by so many things. It's like, yeah, and yeah, how much cotton did you have to pick in the field to this week? sweet FA. What's your quota on the sugarcane harvest? Oh, it's nothing, because that's not your job as an indentured servant or slave or plantation worker or whatever. These people, I think, in deprived areas of the United States, and there's shocking poverty. Yeah? It shouldn't be there. And I agree. The first world's largest economy, what is regularly held to be the best country in the world for a great number of things, but you still have many more opportunities than other people do. I mean, bloody hell.
Also, there is the fact that we're losing you again for some reason. There we go. Okay.
I must be moving away from the microphone. Yeah. I move away from the microphone to breathe in. Chocolate rain.
Anyway, and the thing is, even there is a lot of black communities that have some problems, a lot of problems, education, jobs and stuff like that. But the thing is, it's not because of race. There is no white boogeyman. There is the fact that it's economic. It's an economic condition, because historically those communities were like that because of how they were before. And now we're in a time where unless you're born into money, it's very difficult for you to go out of that. When they say the middle class is disappearing, it means that either you're rich or you can struggle to put a meal on the table even with a full job. That's the kind of time we live in. It's a time where the social escalator is fucking stuck, because they don't redistribute economic earnings, money, wealth equally. And this is what's happening. But by making you focus on race, they can keep on doing whatever the fuck they want. That's the thing. But no, you keep on focusing on race. I'm sure that's going to help you in the long run. Your children, your grandchildren.
Keep the rage going. Keep the rage going. Don't worry about the rich man in the room pickpocketing your wallet.
Yeah.
Don't worry about the super rich not paying their fair share of taxes. and somehow because they happen to be part of the old boys network, getting away with murder, in some cases literally.
Don't care about the fact that it seems like the recipes because of fucking keenness, whatever, that fucking moron. The recipe for everyone to solve the crisis is put less money into people's pockets. That doesn't... Yeah, just don't care about that. Keep on focusing on race. I'm sure your descendants will thank you because if we, like the millennials, have a shitty situation ahead of us, I don't know what kind of situation my little brother, who right now is only 15, is going to be in. Like, just...
He has two older brothers and a great father and mother are going to put him, smack him upside the head when he's being a little dork.
but I worry more about the rest of the world. That's the thing.
Without saying wanting to advocate beating children, sometimes children do need a little physical discipline.
Like the one who got into the gorilla cage, huh?
Yeah. Keep close to your parents at the zoo, kid. There's a reason for that. Why? Because when they get too close to the glass and the thing lunges at you, you're going to shit yourself.
The times I've gone to the zoo, and for some reason I have to pass by the reptile cages. I'm so glad that plexiglass is military grade because I'm afraid of those damn animals lunging at my neck.
Snake. All right. Moving on to something more laughable, no matter how you look at this is just going to make people laugh. Blizzard Entertainment has declared war on porn. Specifically, they want to remove every trace of Overwatch SFM porn from the internet. How do you think that's going to go, guys?
Well, it's going to go badly. because as the sign says,
porn now.
Well, it's like, oh, we can't have porn of this, right? I'll go and make that. Now, I did hear in defense of Blizzard and thing. One thing I did hear about what it was going to be, is they're concerned about people ripping game assets and using that for their porn. Now, it's a bit different from me drawing a picture of Tracer's ass, and me ripping game assets and putting those and recoloring those and changing that, using that as the basis of my porn, which is very different, and I don't approve of.
That's the legal base. Like, they're in the right to remove that because. They're in the right. It's in their legal right to send the cease and desist orders to that kind of stuff. But the thing is, they've been doing it for years now. And not only with Overwatch, but also with their other properties. Like Heroes of the Storm, World of Warcraft. Machinima has been existing since the mid-2000s. But why do you think Overwatch is different? Why do you think this crackdown, Eagle?
The thing is, Overwatch is still in that gray area where technically it would fall. If it were a movie, it would be a PG-13. Yeah, there is cartoon animated violence, but you're not seeing blood. You're not seeing gory details. You're just man down. So you're gonna see a lot of tweens getting into Overwatch because it's the coolest new game out there. It's an FPS mobile battle arena, and all the cool kids are playing it. And what is the first thing they're going to do? They're going to go onto Google and type Tracer. And what's the first 5-10 hits going to be? Tracer porn.
Well, they do know there is the base Google settings don't let you see R-rated stuff. Unless you specifically ask for it.
Exactly. But so, here's the thing. The thing is, Blizzard is right now trying to do a lockdown on as much of that content not being made easily available.
They know it's a losing battle, and it's gonna Barbara Streisand up their wazoo like everything else, because there's gonna be more porn of it out there. They just want to make sure there's some kind of lockdown, so it's not the first 20 to 50 hits.
Yeah, well, after the...
If you really want to find the porn, you know the usual sites to go hunt them down.
Well, these people need to practice their Google Foo a bit better, quite frankly. And what parent lets their children get onto the internet unsupervised, unfiltered? Because that's what leads to seeing things they shouldn't. I mean, well, remember what it is when the first time we have a dictionary and such, you look up all the rude words, don't you? So that's I can understand why they want to keep it thing, because apparently, you know, because there is other competition on there, because there's also Battleborn, which apparently isn't as good. From what I gather, I haven't played it. I don't have a suitable machine to play it on. And yeah, and as Grayson was saying in the chat, the outrage and such. Remember, they did remove one of Tracer's poses where she was looking from behind.
Yeah,
the backside pointed out. Yes, sir. Yeah.
They put in a new pose that was literally a pin-up pose. So.
Yep.
Like, what? Yeah, I think they're saying just lip service because, you know, they're not stupid. They know that people now are going to make even more porn or that kind about Overwatch. They knew, like, there is porn of everything. Like, there is even porn of the feminist
rule 34.
Gap. Like,
rule 34.
Rule 34. If you can think of it, there is porn on the internet of it.
Well, yeah, and that's how publishers in Japan know how popular their manga series is, how much doujinshi is there of it. Well, there's no porn to doujinshi. Oh, well, sales are quite low, so, you know, sorry, mate, you're getting cancelled. You're getting cancelled unless you bring in more sexy characters for people to perv over. I'm not saying it's right, I'm just saying that's how it kind of happened.
In a sense, you can think about it this way. It's a market indicator.
Yeah, the more porn... at least, you know, among teens and young adults, and maybe some very precocious twins. Like, very precocious. Because I don't know when I don't know when kids start looking at porn nowadays. I mean, I think I started looking at... I was 14 when I saw my first porn image. You know, it was like a drawing of, I think it was a Dragon Ball Z hentai pic, something like that. I was 14. I don't know. I don't want to know, really.
Was it Mai or Launch?
No, it was Fidel with Gohan. Short-haired Fidel.
Well, yeah. Kids are going to look for things they shouldn't do because they're told they shouldn't look for them. And that's just it's human nature. Don't look for this sort of thing. This sort of... Why? Because I don't want you to see it. Why doesn't you want me to see it? Here we are. And
now,
then...
There's a thing I want to talk about there because having a couple of nieces, one of them barely being 13, the other one's 18... there's cases where, you don't want to have kids watch porn at a young age because it's normalizing them to certain activities that they're not ready for.
Yeah, also, you know, some things in porn, you know, are not exactly normal. Like, you don't want to normalize certain acts, not because they're impossible, but because they require some preparation that the porn usually skims over. I don't want to say more here. I think.
Eden, you don't want everybody to be lopping around with a what size was it, Ra? 16 IBRC.
Someone say something. This is very awkward. Ra, we ask you a question here. Hello?
I think Ross modem having issues again.
There we go. Yeah, it just dropped. Okay.
But yeah.
So
it's a case where, you know what? Yeah, I understand why they want to... they want to not necessarily censor it, but they want to make sure that some of the public content out there is less risque. Like Grayson said, sure, they're doing lip service to keep the PG-13 rating or the whatever the zero rating is or the whatever the gaming rating is to keep it low so they can sell more. Mm-hmm. But also it's helping them get more attention, more shock appeal, and that's correct. But at the same time, it's good that they care about it because, you know what, we don't want those kids having a rude awakening too young.
Yeah, I mean, also not on their own, because already most parents are scared, like they like, oh no, I have to talk about my children, about the facts of life. Oh my god, please, someone do it for me, I don't want to do it. Learning from porn is not exactly ideal, no. Yeah. Yeah.
I actually got I got Grayson on another different Skype chat.
Yeah.
Looks like the speaker chat's kind of wonky a little bit. And I want to read out what he's saying. Let's be completely honest. There is no way in hell that Blizzard created character models like Widowmaker and Mercy alone, let alone Tracer's relatively modest figure, but put them in skin tight ass hugging suits. So it's like they can't really say no. We did not expect Literal 34 to happen because it's like saying like in my case. It's like saying, I play Senran Kagura because of the ninjas. not because of the boobs. Come on.
Yeah, that's like that thing. Do you know, I saw the video, like the Let's Play from Team 4 Stars about...
You mean from Vegeta's Renegade for Life.
Yeah, Vegeta Renegade. Yeah, welcome back, Will. Yeah. I saw the Vegeta Renegade for Life video, like when he does a Let's Play about Senran Kagura, and there is like the intro where all the girls are in white swimsuits and dancing and the singing. It was one of the most ridiculous things I ever seen. Like all
and the end was so glorious.
All the boobies and nakedness and asses and. So over the top. I was laughing my ass off.
Praise Michael.
Who's Michael? Who's Michael?
Tated. Tated's all day, everything.
Oh, okay.
Tated's all day, everything. Praise Michael.
I'm not quite sure how much of my terrible thing you actually heard before I got cut off there, but we'll...
Try again.
Oh, it was a discussion of porn and people getting into things they're not ready for, and it's like, yeah, you really don't want to come home to find out when your children's into water sports or anything like that, because, you know, that's just wrong. Moving swiftly along, you really can't expect them to... You're always going to have fan service. I mean, the Overwatch characters themselves are... pretty fun service. I mean, they're not
for life.
Oh yeah, they're not as bad as Seren Kagura the titty ninjas or Dragon's Crown. But you know, they're pretty fun service. You notice how they're not all like the typical sock just feminists.
No, pretty much no.
Because nobody's going to want to play the game. Nobody looks for... People look for idealized versions that they can aspire to. And sometimes we're never going to aspire... Yeah, we aspire all you want. You are never going to reach these standards. But it's nice. It's a nice little fantasy to have. That's why most porn actresses tend to be quite attractive. Yeah, and it's like, really? Do you really want to see ugly people getting naked and such? No, you don't want that.
We don't.
Yeah, not in the mainstream, obviously. With porn being the ultimate in free market economics, I want to see this. Are you willing to pay for it? Yes. Well, let's negotiate a price, and there we go. That's how it works.
You have it.
I can sympathise with them wanting to keep it clean, and I can also laugh at them for trying to do so. But yeah, it's the source filmmaker stuff they're complaining about, not hand-drawn hentai, which, you know, the source film is the source of most Mass Effect porn.
Eagle, like, you can't write something that, that funny and not say it live. You know, stop chatting and read that comment.
So it's from the other chat with chatting with Grayson, and it was actually a response to him where what we were saying a little few minutes ago that, Blizzard may not be straight up fishing for responses like they did with the Tracer Wind Pose debacle happened, but they know what's going to happen here. So what they're doing is they're paying enough lip service for the for a younger audience that's suitable to keep the rating image and the public image shiny. And to quote him, it's quote unquote and big old quotation marks. We are SF safe for work, honest. Wink, wink, nudge, wink. Nudge. Close parentheses thing. And I retort with no. It's the internet age. If you don't do your parental guidance better, your kids probably know better sexual positions than you.
Yeah. And even if you do parental guidance, that still has a chance to happen.
In all fairness, Minus, you're Italian. I mean, it's like, let's see some naked breasts on TV. I mean, that does happen a lot on Italian television, if I remember correctly.
Not as much. Like, naked breasts, not so much. Like, skimpy dressed women and presenters and stuff like that, a lot. But naked, not really, no.
Skimpy dressed women on television? It's like my Mexican telenovelas.
Yeah.
I remember because...
Not as much as you would like to believe, Gra.
Not as bad as German TV. There was a German comedian, late night talk show host, referring to one of their channels, RTL. So it's known as the Titty Channel, because, you know, softcore pornography after midnight and what have you. And it's like, I may have had satellite TV in the late 80s, early 90s, and seen more than my fair share of naked breasts on such a channel. But, you know,
Oh my god, I just remember something terrible.
What?
My first porn movie.
Oh no, we don't really want to know, Manos.
Yeah, just, I was 12 and my little brother was 10. Oh my god. Why did I remember that?
Was it actually a good porn now that you're older?
It was.
Or are you just remembering
pink
glasses of childhood?
At the nice backgrounds, great production value, I have to say.
Well, at least it wasn't Caligula.
Of course, in the UK, let's see, when I was 12-ish, 12, 13, I was doing a paper round, and a couple of people on my paper round in the morning had The Sun and The Daily Star, which had page 3, which was like, oh, let's see what page she had. Oh, she's got nice norks. It's The Sun. Yeah, it's terrible. Oh, yeah, some naked breasts in it. You get over it, kid. You know, for some people, that's all the nudity they get to see in a day.
Hashtag page 3.
Hashtag page three. Defend page three. Defend page three. Don't let it be.
Yeah, there is a thing where it is, people do want to get rid of it. And I can see the reason thing. It is somewhat shameful and anachronistic. I mean, it is current year. I mean, back in the 70s when that sort of thing came out, then yeah, a lot of things in the 70s were okay then and not okay now. Blackface, a lot of comedy goes like, that's a bit rapey, that is. Like, that's a bit sinister. No wonder we need Operation U-Tree. I mean,
Yeah, then, but, you know, it's naked, not naked, like sexy people in sexy poses, like, okay, so you take away page three, there is underwear commercials, perfume commercials, for both men and women, both sexy naked men and sexy naked women. You don't need to, like, get up in arms about page three, because it's, I don't know.
Yeah, and well, it's because it's traditionally the models were young ladies with their clothes off. It's like not exactly a great start in a fulfilling career, as some would have it. But some people, if you like taking your clothes off and you get paid for it, more power to you.
More power to you, indeed. Some people may want to stop you from doing that.
Oh yeah. Well, you know how it is with the Xbox E3 thing, Microsoft party. Oh, these dancers shouldn't be doing this. It's like, well, so you're limiting their employment options.
Yep.
So it backfires.
Yeah, kind of. Okay, last thoughts on the Overwatch Blizzard thing, because we're running out of time and I want to do something with you before finishing it today.
Scandalous. I'm not sure I consent to that. I understand why they're going after this source filmmaker porn, and you know, best of luck with that. But you know, you're never going to get rid of porn. People will find other things. They will do whatever they can to get their rocks off, even if it start. Yeah, okay. Suddenly, we're going to start writing porn again. That's how it's going to work. You ain't going to ever get rid of porn. Doesn't matter who you are or what it is.
You, Eagle?
I want to commend them on trying to keep it clean and make sure that the little kids that are still impressionable, because a lot of them aren't anymore, that are still trying to keep them, well, not so much affected or not so much damaged. Like Ross said, it's going to be it's an uphill and almost Sisyphean effort that they're going to be doing, yeah. And more power to them. But we all know in the end, it's like, just might as well enjoy the clicks.
Pretty much.
And enjoy the traffic, enjoy the clicks, and enjoy all those extra players, because give them a year or two, there's going to be something else that's going to be the Overwatch killer if they try.
Yeah, personally, I own Overwatch. I'm really enjoying it, and I'm really enjoying also what comes with it from the community, because there is a lot of fan art going on, and not only hentai. The hentai is all very high quality, I have to say. But even everything else, I like the community is building around this game, and it's very colorful. It's very fun to play, and I'm a guy who usually doesn't like first person shooters. This reminds me of the last first person shooters that I played the hell out of. That was Left 4 Dead. I love that game. So. Do whatever you have to do, but just, this is just lip service to keep stuff off you porn, I guess, because that could get picked up by Google, but just don't go too crazy, because, you know, just do what you have to do. Okay, and well, now, like, yes, go Eagle, sorry. Go Eagle.
Like I said, you know what, with hentai, and actually there was a comment also that Grayson said, in Japan, there is a it's good luck getting the Japanese fans to stop drawing porn of anything ever. Because you know what? It actually is somewhat of a market indicator in Japan. Yeah, some of the stuff is not safe for work, and sometimes some of the stuff is not safe for life. But a lot of the content actually is pretty tied in with some of the storylines, or some of them it's just fans saying, "Hey, I like this character, and I want to get my rocks off to something a little less into the mythos and a little bit more romantic, or at least a little bit more kinky."
a little more kinky. All right. Before we go, I wanted to try and do that thing with you, which you know I proposed to you, using
what
sync,
thing?
The thing with sync video, where we react to stuff, because hey, those guys aren't you know suing people on YouTube anymore, so we can do it.
Yeah, are they still hemorrhaging subscribers?
Yeah,
because so, I remember seeing the count thing going. I was like, "Oh, bad."
So let's do the, because all the cool kids are doing it, and let's react to stuff. So I'm linking to you the room. This is a sync video room. If you in the chat want to join, I'm going to paste the link in the chat for Spreaker as well. Come join us there. I have full command of the video right now. So, have you guys are you guys fans of this series?
Some of them. Some of them can be a bit tedious. But yeah, they're all right. So yeah, let's see what we got.
All right. Give me a sec.
I love how this sync video gave me a random name, Eager Grouse. Oh yeah.
I think I had a left-handed tamarind or something. It's like, oh okay, a tamarind monkey. Marvelous. Right.
Okay, so I'm going to start the video now. Have you either of you seen this before?
Not this one. I'm familiar with the format, but I've not seen that.
Okay.
I've used a different software. Actually, an application that actually connects to a similar service, just a different application.
Okay, you had to tell me about that, so maybe we can use that in the next time, because this one, like, the sound doesn't go direct into Spreaker, because it's on the web and stuff like that. So, okay, we'll set up this better next time. Now, there we go. They look identical.
Boat yard, sex case. Hey.
I love the way she looks at him.
And Hodor.
Hodor.
Chirac. Around the few shirts of gray. Mass alliteration. No more. The best programming. Oh. And the gate opens. Well, I personally love this when first, like, it's like 2 weeks old. The next episode should come out tomorrow, and I loved it. I really loved it. So, what do you think? What do you think about, you know, all the references to their books and stuff they did? What do you think?
Yeah, entirely legit. As the Top Tips Twitter feed said, save money on expensive Game of Thrones box sets by watching Lord of the Rings and pausing every 10 minutes to watch some porn. there's bits of Game of Thrones that I like. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's sort of thing. And I can appreciate bits of Game of Thrones more than Lord of the Rings.
That happens, yeah.
Do like a bit of gritty realism, and, you know, who doesn't like seeing a good pair of Milky Swingers every now and again? But yeah, there's like, it does get a bit relentlessly grim. I mean, the Iron Islands, bloody piss and cardboard, a lot of it. I mean, I can appreciate. Yeah, I understand why you like the fancy elements of Game of Thrones more than the real world politicking thing, because you get enough of that.
I get too much of that in my life. So basically, the line that I liked more, like, in the battle, is when he says, yes, it's true to life for cutters to ride randomly, because the word yes is full of chance and anarchy, but newsflash, the genre is called fucking fantasy. It's meant to be unrealistic. And that's not really a criticism for George R. Martin, because you can write whatever. I don't have, you don't have to write just because stuff that I have to like 100% always. You can write whatever you want. But it's when you talk to fans, like, most of the time they say, oh, you know, you don't understand, or can you not like it? This is good, it's so realistic. That's not a merit for a fantasy book. Eagle?
Yeah.
You've been pretty silent. If anything,
you know what? Speaking first about the epic rap battle video, I'll give it to Tolkien. He had the way they wrote him, it slammed and dug better on Martin versus Martin on what Martin had on Tolkien.
Yeah, me too.
But for both writers, each of them has their great merits and their flaws. For example, for Tolkien, I love how he's pretty much become, if not the father, the second father of modern high fantasy.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
What would you say is the first, though? That you made me curious now.
The thing is, Tolkien did take from classic high fantasy and classic mythologies from other, from different races and different peoples. So it's like the high fantasy existed already with, like, say, the ancient Greeks, the ancient Norse, the ancient Britons, etc. So a lot of the fantasy already exists, but it wasn't really recompiled into a story that was more less historically valid and more imagination based, more original story.
Yeah, I can understand what you mean. And see, yes, personally, me too. Like, rap battle wise, I had to give it to Tolkien, because he just had more things to say that hurt. You know, because it's true. He's He sold book-wise a lot more than Tolkien. And Tolkien sold a lot more than Martin. And yes, Martin has the HBO series, but Tolkien has the movies, which you could argue actually improved on his books. And Led Zeppelin. Like, Led fucking Zeppelin took inspiration for their lyrics and songs from the works of Tolkien. How can you beat that?
Yeah. Also, you know what? Well, Martin has the benefit of the books having been adapted to a TV series. So a cable TV series, so they can do the extra bloody battle gore and all extra sexy titty-titty ass titty-titty.
Yeah, if Game of Thrones had been on pretty much almost any other network, if it had only been on basic cable, not premium cable like HBO is, it would not get the ratings. I mean, some people watch Game of Thrones because, you know, they want to see pretty girls with the clothes off.
Yeah, which, you know, or violence, gory violence. There is also that.
Yeah, if Game of Thrones couldn't be as true to the books as it was, it would not work as a TV. It's got to be full on, otherwise, what's the point for Game of Thrones?
Yeah, and even then, it's not exactly full on, because, you know, there are some characters that have been fused into others, because they were cut, and there were things that were added, and I had to argue that some were just for shock value. Like when the Red Woman convinces that guy to burn his daughter to the stake, which fans of the books tell me is so not in character, it's not even funny.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the thing is, they have to adapt so much, cut so much, because they can only do so much per season.
Yeah.
So they can't really do a one-to-one adaptation from the books to the TV series, else it would be longer than America's most long-running soap opera. And as much as we love the all the political drama and all the dragons and everything, we're getting just enough to keep us hooked and not enough to tell us, okay, I'm done with this shit.
Yeah, pretty much. It's I feel that it's turning into I think we're coming to that point that as Naruto fans reached. Like, there is a point that they're straddling that level where you're just about done, but also you're so invested. I mean, they're not there yet, but they could get there.
They're getting there, but they're staying on board because they know there will be an ending eventually.
Eventually.
Now, how many books are we still waiting for?
I think the ending will come from the TV series. I don't think we're ever going to get the final book. I don't think we ever get. I don't think so. No. No.
But if in case, how many books more would we still be getting? Two more? Three more?
I think two. But each one bigger than the other, that's never going to happen. I don't think that's ever going to happen. And I hope to God that the finale isn't going to be like a finale like the one from How I Met Your Mother.
How I trolled the audience for so many years.
Because can you imagine? Because, okay, people were invested in How I Met Your Mother. But in How I Met Your Mother, people didn't die so often. So many characters, and a lot of people really liked. And maybe two of them died as zeros. We can talk about Hodor, I think, now, no?
Yeah, I mean, that was shocking and sad, because, you know, as people said, Hodor was... Yeah, so spoiler. Hodor was one of the few people who didn't have an agenda. Because everyone assumed he was...
He was one of the few people that you generally liked. And it was sad. He got screwed up, his life screwed up by Bran. What the hell is it with the pure-blooded Starks and screwing up other people's lives, anyway? So, basically, he's maybe one of the only two people that have died kind of an heroic way so far, because, okay, he got his life screwed up, but he died protecting a little kid, which was the cause of everything, but he died protecting someone, and he protected him by a horde of White Walkers. Like, that's fucking badass. That's badass. That's hero's death. How many people in Game of Thrones have had that kind of death so far?
Very few.
So
very few get an awesome death. You know, it's one of those kind of deaths that you hear about when people talk up to you about death metal or heavy metal. It's like, ah!
Yeah, pretty much. So yeah.
Also, all those pure bloods and Starks and everything, come on, they're pure bloods. They're royalty. They're nobility. They have privilege.
Yeah.
Like, that's the reason. Basically, the only character that more or less fits the hero archetype is Jon Snow, pretty much. He's the hero, technically, of the story.
Yeah, there was somebody did a joke about the Hodor thing on Twitter.
What did they say?
I was linked into the Spreaker chat. It was quite a good one because in the recent weeks, Boris Johnson has been mentioning Hitler, which is never a good thing for a politician to do, except when discussing certain things. And then they reference the Game of Thrones, Hold the Door, Hodor. It's Hit the Gorilla, Hit the Gorilla. And quite frankly, that's something that more people need to have seen. But those sort of things, like, that's brilliant.
With all these characters that have died horrible deaths that people liked, with all that people I've invested in this series, can you imagine if they had a finale like How I Met Your Mother?
Oh god,
the reaction.
People are going to find George R. R. Martin and they're going to kick him to death. He's gonna be kicked to death.
People are gonna pull a Cartman. They're gonna pull a South Park. They're gonna go find him and feed him his own floppy wieners.
Oh yeah, too right.
Yeah, pretty much because these are now mainstream series, pretty much, and mainstream people. But most people, okay, so you have a lot of bad shit happening, a lot of thing, but they always hope that it's going to be worth it for a good finale. Please, you can, if you, you know what I mean. Like, the whole story grim and dark, at least the finale has to be a little more uplifting, just a little.
I don't know, the
problem there, it's been so dark and grim and glum and gory, and it's starting to be its own event horizon. We're not able to escape because there's not enough happiness, and I don't think it was supposed to be anyway.
George R. R. Martin did say Heisenberg is the most evil character on television I've ever seen. I'm going to have to change something. I'm going to have to write it home and do something about that. write another character just as evil, even more evil. Ramsay Bolton. But yeah. The ending can't be the White Walkers killing everybody in Westeros.
Yeah, or...
Can you imagine
it would be a finale like Othello? Or, you know... Othello or Hamlet.
And then Grayson in the chat goes like, "Well, Martin might still go full Urobuchi, you know, Mister Grim Dark, Grim Derp for all the monies."
Well, it could be, as I say, I don't believe in happiness and happy endings for children's books. Oh, Ben. Oh.
Yes, I don't believe in happiness and happy endings are for children's books. Urobuchi, the butcher.
Yeah, and I had to call bullshit on that because the finale of Kamen Rider Gaim, which he wrote, wasn't exactly a completely happy ending, but it was happy. You know.
Yeah,
they probably told him, "Hey, quit shitting the universe up. This is Kamen Rider. This is not your dark fantasy." And then he went to write for Nitro Plus and Fate Zero.
Yeah. Like, stop.
What else could happen? It's like, well, something could happen and everyone gets turned into Tang, like in Evangelion. Everyone's turned into orange. Well, then again, the dragons could go nuts and incinerate everybody. I mean,
burninating.
Well, yeah, because those are our options.
Yeah. Also, the fact with Madoka Magica. Also, he doesn't believe in happy ending, but in Madoka Magica, he basically at the end, Madoka resurrects everyone. So you know.
Until the movies.
Yeah.
Until the movie.
Yeah, but she still does. So, you know. Okay.
Just because they're all resurrected doesn't mean you can expect them all to stay alive. I mean, come on. There's only so much you can do.
Yeah, I think. I think the thing is, he maybe doesn't believe it. He says that. That happy endings are for children. But the thing is, he understands that there is a little bit of a child in everyone. Especially if you like things like video games and books. Because there's still a lot of stigma around things like anime. Even fantasy books and shows like Game of Thrones. That if you watch them, you're not completely an adult, like you're immature and stuff like that, you know? So I think he understands.
People who write badly written S&M fantasy for people who got no idea.
You can take that in two ways, like you say, right? It's a badly written S&M fantasy, or these products are just they're just cartoons to shell out toys.
Yeah, pretty much. Also, he understands, I think Robuchi understands very well, that you need a balance. Even if you want to have a bad ending, you have to sprinkle happiness, laughter, something all over the place. Because otherwise, people are going to be used to bad shit happening.
Yeah, it literally piss and cardboard. Which is a reference to Charlie Brooker's TV Go Home. Which is Charlie Brooker was anonymous before anonymous was a thing, because he didn't have his name on it. But when he started the original website TV Go Home, which was a parody of the TV listings, and they had things like programs. What was it? It was Piss and Cardboard, Relentlessly Grim Soap Opera. Somebody goes around, reverses over the car, goes in the car, reverses over the pet dog and shit like that. It's like, oh god. He's obviously it's parody.
And your little dog too.
That's going way too grim derp for me.
What?
All that. It's like, you know what? Yeah, I understand you want to make it mature and more adult, but you don't need to go full grim derp. Come on.
Yeah, because the adult doesn't mean sad. That's a thing that needs to go the fuck away. Mature and adult doesn't mean that you have to be miserable all the time.
We're already miserable as it is. We don't need more.
Yeah, and we wouldn't need to be. There is this social stigma, like, that if you're an adult, as soon as you get out of school, okay, you go to college and you have to get a work and you get to be miserable 24/7. Fuck you! I'm going to be perfectly happy when I want to, and get angry when I want to.
Yeah, and the trick to a good life, happy life, is balance. Mm-hmm. And you can't have joy and success in everything, because you kind of don't learn that much. But what you, so it's part of the it's struggling. So it can't be misery all of the time, because that's no way to live. And no, you can't go everything is problematic, because fuck me, that's just no way to live at all. There's no people have no joy in their lives. It's awful. But you got to be serious sometimes, but you can't be serious all the time. So you got to strike the happy balance, you know, work life and all this. It's like, oh, I do something productive at work, but now I can go and make people's lives better at home and what have you. So that's the sort of thing it needs to be. It's one of the things, say, sci-fi, until we got to our rash of young adult misery dystopian futures. The thing is, sci-fi is like how it could be. It's like it could be if you wanted it to be that way, versus fantasy. So like, it's like this because I'm the author. I want it to be like this.
Okay, so authors out there, like, it's fine. Like, it's fine. It's fine. You can have happiness and stuff. No, hell, you have to have some happiness. Even if it's bittersweet, you can't sustain your story on darkness alone. Even horrors have to have lighthearted moments. Unless Lovecraft. But the thing is, Lovecraft made the mostly short stories, because you can't handle all that misery in long sittings, especially series as long as an anime or as Game of Thrones. So it's okay. Just give us something, because at least in the finale, because otherwise you're going to be... you're not going to be remembered that well. If you don't... You got to have some payoffs. What you don't give during the story, you have to give in the finale, or vice versa. You can't end everything like Devilman.
Yeah. If everything is misery throughout the series, and the people expect a bad ending, and then you go, well, that's just made me feel terrible. And it's one of these things like, why would you want to watch a film that makes you cry? But sometimes you need to let out that emotion and such. But it's like, oh, it's all awful, and then he succeeds. Well, yeah, main character dies, but he completes his thing and he saves the world. It's like, brilliant, fair enough. Or it's like, everything's going right, and then suddenly turns to shit in the last minute. It's like, oh, well, that's life. Fair enough.
Fair enough.
So you got to balance it. But yeah, these.
Yeah. Can you imagine? Like, last question. Can you imagine if Requiem for a Dream had no hope in it? Because the finale of Requiem for a Dream is soul crushing. But the thing is, during the movie, there is hope. Without hope in the movie, the finale would have never been so iconic.
It's iconic because it's part of the whole theory that you can't have light without darkness, and it's always darkest before the dawn. So, as deep and as philosophical as something, sometimes you want to have that little glimmer of hope to think, you know what, life isn't that shit. It's got its great moments, and yeah, you have to put up with the crap to actually get to the good stuff.
But the thing is, the good stuff exists. So, when you put everything that, say, everything is awful, you're kind of becoming unrealistic. Ironically enough. Too unrealistic.
When you're too realistic, when you say everything's shit, blah, 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 it's because you already went off the deep end on one side and you still forgot to, right? Lift your head up. See the sun? Yeah, there's still sunlight.
Yep.
It's not completely dark.
Not close.
Yeah, it's like the film The Road from the Cormac McCarthy novel. It's like, yeah, the world's dying. This is not going to end well for us. But, yeah, you've got to compel the audience. As a writer, you have one job. Entertain the audience. Entertain the reader. Now, you entertain the reader by giving quality dialogue and compelling characters.
You have to get away from your stuff with a good time.
Yes. If everyone's, I read that and I wasn't entertained, or I was bored out of my skull, or I couldn't get through that, it was awful for whatever reason, then you have failed that reader. Now, not everyone will like what you write. That's life. You can't please everyone. You can try to please as many as you can, but sometimes you've got to leave well enough alone and say, well, it's not for it's only for people who like this a particular sort of thing. Otherwise, you get the broadest possible appeal. It would be like Game of Thrones without the tits and violence. Nobody wants to watch that, quite frankly. Mm-hmm. Sopranos without Tony Soprano, without going into the detail of his day job, why he's having these problems and needs to talk to a psychiatrist. You're kind of lacking that because you think, it means nothing. Because if you don't see the stresses of his, of his criminal life, you think he's just a weak man with a bad family. I've gone off on a tangent. I've forgotten where I was saying that.
Yeah, no.
No change there.
Anyway, we have, we started from a rap battle, anyway. So, because we have to finish. So, Eagle, Ra, who do you think won?
Oh, I'm talking.
Tolkien. Okay. Alright, guys, this has been fun, and I guess we should do the stuff about, whatever reactions we want to do in separate sittings, because, wow, that was fun anyway. So, we'll see you next Sunday, or whenever, yep. Because, I work in an airport, so we're not always going to be able to do this on Sundays, if not, and maybe not every week, because, different schedules, different time zones, whatever. So, we'll see you next time. As always, I want to thank my co-hosts, Igor Ceres.
Gracias, amigos.
And Lord Ra.
Goodbye, everybody.
This is Menos Kain. Ciao!